Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome. I'm Merit Gino, Dean of the School of International Public Affairs, and I'd really like to welcome everyone here to this very special program featuring High Commissioner Antonio Guterres. This is actually an extraordinary gathering at a very important time, and I think it stands out in my mind for three reasons. First of all, we're engaging an issue of critical importance in the world at a really sensitive and important time, which is, of course, the issue of forced displacement. Second, we have with us people who have been so deeply engaged and responsible for these issues that I can imagine no more enriched conversation than the one that we're about to have. And I think third, SIPA is celebrating our 70th anniversary and our deep history of engaging critical issues and indeed our deep history with the United Nations. We were formed around the same time as the United Nations by some of the same people involved in those early efforts. And so all of these elements come together tonight. Tonight is also sponsored by a part of SIPA, the International Fellows Program, and we have with us a number of international fellows who represent the students at Columbia University, at SIPA and Columbia, who have been coming together since 1960, I believe, to an interdisciplinary group who think about the major challenges facing the world today and U.S. foreign policy. So with this deep history, it is my enormous pleasure to open tonight's discussion. And I think we're also joined by the director of the International Fellows Program. So what can I say about our guest of honor? He has had a remarkable career in public service, both at the United Nations and in government and in his home country in Portugal. For a decade, from 2005 to 2015, he served as High Commissioner for Refugees at the United Nations. And during his tenure, he oversaw profound structural reforms. He increased expenditures and addressed just a record number of displaced persons affected by conflict and persecution, apparently from 38 million to 2005 to almost 60 million in 2015. His tenure was marked by some of the largest displacement crises in modern history. And under his leadership, the office took remarkable steps to overlook a number of very important overlooked problems. He established the annual dialogue on protection challenges. And before his service as High Commissioner, he spent more than 20 years in government and public service, including serving as the Prime Minister of Portugal from 1995 to 2002, in which he was also involved in many important regional crises, including the crisis in Timor. He was President of the European Council, and he led the adoption of the Lisbon Agenda. He founded the Portuguese Refugee Council. And tonight, he will share his views on present trends of forced displacement. And this will be followed in a discussion with Professors Doyle and Aleinikoff of Columbia University. And I will just briefly introduce them, and then we'll go directly into your remarks. Michael Doyle is a professor at SIPA, at the Law School, the Department of Political Science, and a university professor here, which is our highest recognition of scholarship and achievement, a real extraordinary contributor to international relations theory, security, and international organizations. And as you know, he himself had a period of service at the United Nations as the Assistant Secretary General and Special Advisor to UN Secretary General Kofi Annan. His responsibilities included the Millennium Development Goals as well as the Global Compact and many other matters. So we're very honored to have Michael leading this discussion. And we're extremely grateful to have with us this year Alexander Aleinikoff, who's a visiting professor at the law school, for spring 2016 and a senior fellow at the Migration Policy Institute in Washington, D.C. He served at the United Nations as the Deputy High Commissioner for Refugees from 2010 to 2015. And prior to that service, he was a professor at Georgetown University Law Center and Dean of the Law School from 2004 to 2010. Much more could be said, but suffice it to say that this is an extraordinary group of experts to engage an issue of critical importance in the world at this moment, and we're very honored to have you with us here today. Thank you very much for joining us.
Well, dear friends, a great pleasure to be here today. As a matter of fact, I've learned a lot thanks to one of your professors, Alex Aleinikoff. So if I do not behave, it's his fault. He was not able to lecture me sufficiently during the time in which we worked together. And I can tell you it's a privilege to work with him. And I think that you are very lucky to have him in your school. Present trends of forced displacement. Well, it's obvious that we are facing a rising trend. A rising trend in forced displacement by conflict. 80% of the people forcibly displaced in the last few years have been displaced by conflict. And that means, essentially, on one side, a multiplication of new conflicts emerging all over the world, more and more interlinked, more and more complex in its nature. Wars are changing also. We no longer have a war between two countries or a government and a rebel group. You have many actors on the ground. And this has more dramatic humanitarian consequences and forces more people to flee. And at the same time, old conflicts seem never to die. Afghanistan, Somalia, the Democratic Republic of Congo are there for decades on and on and on, with more and more people being victimized and more people being displaced. On the other hand, we have, if you look at the global mega trends, population growth, climate change, and probably climate change is the biggest accelerator of all the other factors, food insecurity, water scarcity, urbanization, all these trends are also combining with each other, intensifying each other's impacts, and multiplying the natural disasters in number, in intensity, in humanitarian consequences, and also accelerating the degradation of environment in different parts of the world. If you look at the Sahel, probably 20 years ago, you would say that in the Sahel, we have a drought every 10 years. Then we started to have a drought every 5 years, and probably now we are moving to have a drought every 2 years. And again, we see more and more people displaced because of these natural disasters and the slow onset of deterioration of living conditions in different parts of the world, which represent about 20% of the people displaced. The overwhelming majority of these 20% displaced within the borders of their own country, but some that cross borders are, they correspond to a gap in the international protection regime. We do not have instruments to deal with the protection problems of these populations. The 51 Convention clearly doesn't cover them, even when we try to have a, I would say, generous interpretation of the 51 Convention. On the other hand, migration has always been considered to be something strictly linked to national sovereignty. There is no multilateral approach to migration still in today's world. And so most of these people face, they are forced to flee, they are forced to move, but they do not have a protection regime that corresponds to the kind of problems they have. A group of countries recently, led by Norway and Switzerland and Germany, with the support of Mexico and Costa Rica, if I remember well, have launched an initiative, the so-called Nansen Initiative. The result of this Nansen Initiative has been an agenda of protection with a certain number of recommendations, but still with a limited number of countries supporting the process and an impact that is, I would say, also very limited. We didn't even manage to have the kind of soft law that the, for instance, guidelines on internal displacement represent in relation to internal displacement, and that were, as a matter of fact, used by the African Union to the drafting of the African Convention on Internal Displacement. So in relation to people crossing borders because of not man-made causes, even if they are man-made to a certain extent, we have a gap in protection, which of course it will be very interesting to analyze also from the point of view of the evolution of our international law. But most of our work has been concentrated on those that cross borders forced to flee by conflict or persecution, that usually either are covered by the 51 Convention, or that states, even if they don't recognize that the 51 Convention covers them, usually accept subsidiary forms of protection that have similar impact and guarantee, or are supposed to guarantee their protection in the circumstances they face. And what is amazing in relation to this displacement by conflict is not the overall numbers. We are talking, as it was said, of about 60 million people when they were only 38 million when I started my mandate, but it is the staggering escalation during the last few years. If you have the number of people displaced by conflict per day, in 2010 we had 11,000 people. 11,000 people displaced per conflict per day, 2010. 2011, 14,000. 2012, 23,000. 2013, 32,000. 2014, 42,500. We have not yet the statistics published for 2015, but I presume that the numbers have probably not gone down. Now, this is a staggering escalation. This escalation has not been noted by the international community until very recently, because 86% of the refugees in the world stay in the developing world. And as they were staying in the developing world, they were rather far from the limelights of the international media and from the limelights of the global political discussion. Now, at a certain moment, during the spring of last year, we witnessed a large movement that for the first time in the last decades, of course, there were, we have the Second World War and many other situations in the past, but for the first time in the last decades, a meaningful number of these refugees, or asylum seekers at least, moved into the developed world. And so, and that to a certain extent is something that should make us think, all of a sudden it became a central issue of the global political debate. Not because there were much more refugees than 1 year before, but because for the first time they were moving into the global north. And of course, that proves that even if we are all equal, it is true that we still are, some are more equal than the others. And this is again something that should make us think about how the world works and how is the perception about the problems and how different that perception is depending on the areas of the world where the problems emerge. Now, what is dramatic in my opinion in the recent past, and to be honest, it was probably more after I left office, and not because I had left office, but because of just the coincidence of things, we are now witnessing something that is relatively new. During my 10 years as High Commissioner, I can say that borders were essentially opened in the world. There were here or there incidents of refoulement, and we have witnessed several, and we have tried to avoid them and sometimes denounced them. We had here or there problems of a border closed, or problems even of some people being pushed back. But thanks to a global positive attitude of governments, thanks to the decisions of courts, for instance, the European Court on Human Rights made several very important decisions, for instance, in relation to the pushbacks from Italy to Libya during Berlusconi's times, or in relation to the Dublin II regulation and movement to back to Greece more recently. Very important decisions in other courts. And I can name courts in the US, courts in the UK, courts in Canada, courts in Kenya, courts in Sudan. That helped keep protection alive and keep borders open. But what we are witnessing now is a situation in which more and more borders are being closed. And as more and more borders are being closed, we are facing this dramatic situation that we have people forced to flee and difficult for these people to have some safe place to go. And obviously, the problem is when it starts, it then spreads like a disease. Because every country has an argument saying, as country A has closed its border, we, country B, cannot do it alone, so we are going to close our border. And for instance, if you look at the situation of Syrians today, it is clear that their capacity to reach safety in Jordan and Lebanon or in Turkey is much more limited than what it was a few years ago. And obviously, it is easier now for these countries to use as arguments the fact that some other borders, namely in the developed world and namely in Europe, are closed, and because of that, they have not the capacity to, by themselves, address the problem. Now, facing this kind of situation, what are the possible ways to address it? It is clear that business as usual is not enough. And it is clear that we need to try to start thinking out of the box on how to face this dramatic increase in displacement with, at the same time, a dramatic closure of the asylum space in several parts of the world. First, I think it is clear that a surge in diplomacy for peace is needed. I believe that we need to be able, as international community, to come together and to address the root causes of conflict, increase the prevention capacity, but at the same time address the conflicts that are now taking place. And it's quite curious. When I was studying in high school, maybe this is a wrong impression, but I had the impression when studying history that the battles or the wars of the past had the winner and the loser. And we are now seeing more and more wars in which nobody wins. Everybody seems to be losing. If you look at the Syria conflict today, I think it's clear that not only nobody is winning in Syria, but it became a dramatic source of instability in the region. Iraq has been completely engulfed by the Syrian war, and today a threat of global peace and security. The number of fighters that are in Syria coming from all parts of the world, namely from this part of the world, but more, of course, from the Middle East, the wider Middle East and from Europe, and the impact that today the Daesh has in the capacity to recruit in societies all over the world and to promote an homegrown terrorism in different parts of the world, means that we are facing a global threat to peace and security by these conflicts. And so the question is, how is it possible to bring together those that have an influence in the parties to the conflict to be able to understand that now everybody is losing and it's better to put aside contradictions, difference of interests, and really put an end to this kind of conflict? If you look at the Syria situation again, it is good to see the United States and Russia, I believe, firmly wanting to work together to find a way to solve the conflict. But it is clear that we need Turkey, Iran, Saudi Arabia, a few other countries of the region, also on board for the conflict to end. But if the countries I mentioned will decide that the conflict will end, I have no doubt that the conflict will end, because without them, the parties to the conflict will have no weapons, no money, no capacity to go on fighting. So this is the moment in which a surge in diplomacy is necessary, and the capacity to bring together those that are relevant in each of the conflicts, and the conflicts are also becoming more and more interlinked, those that are relevant in each of the conflicts can play a role in order to be able to put an end to some of the conflicts we are facing, and at the same time to avoid and to invest in both prevention and conflict resolution and in the sustainability of peace once peace is reached in several parts of the world, which means essentially to be able to address the problems of fragility of states, of institutions and societies in several of the areas where we in the past, as UNHCR, were operating, be it in the Middle East, in Africa, in South Asia, Southwest Asia, and in other parts of the world. Second thing that seems to me absolutely crucial is to have a meaningful increase in both humanitarian support to people displaced, but in support to the countries that are in the first line in relation to displacement. Countries like Lebanon or Jordan in relation to Syria, or the Kenya and Ethiopia in relation to Somalia, or Cameroon, Chad, or Niger in relation to Nigeria, are countries that are more and more not only large recipients of refugees. Remember, 86% stay in the developing world, but they are also pillars of stability in regions that are themselves quite fragile, and sometimes the first line of defense of our collective security. Now, what has been dramatic is that the support to these countries has been out of proportion with the impact that in the economy and in the society, this huge inflow of refugees associated with the security problems created by the conflicts themselves have had in them. And so it is clear that not only they have not the capacity to provide good conditions for the refugees they receive. If you look at Lebanon or Jordan, the Syrian refugees, 90% are below poverty line. Only half go to school. Nobody is authorized to work, or if there are now some small steps in this direction, namely in relation to the agreements that were made with Turkey and with some movements in relation to Jordan. But normally the overwhelming majority has not the legal right to work. And obviously we cannot blame these countries for this situation because their capacity to absorb this huge number of people is very limited. Some of these countries are middle income, and because of that they are excluded from different instruments of international cooperation. I was very happy to see that after we have been fighting for this for years, the World Bank has finally got the approval of the board to have grants to refugee hosting countries, namely Lebanon and Jordan, because in the past this was not possible. And they were not also in the first priority of development cooperation policies around the world, because those development cooperation policies were, if I may say something a little bit probably unfair, were essentially led by strictly development-related issues and not sufficiently paying attention to the questions of fragility that started to be taken into account, but more than to the questions of fragility, not taking sufficient into account the situation of those countries that are, as I said, in the front line of instability, and that play not only a huge humanitarian role, providing a global public service, but also are essential elements for global stability and global security. I hope that this is something that the world is waking up to, and I believe it is in the interest of everybody to meaningfully increase both the humanitarian aid to those displaced and the development cooperation support to those countries of the first line that I mentioned. Third thing that I believe is essential is when we see movements of people that remind us of the boat people in the 70s, and we see so many borders being closed, I think this is high time for the international community to come together and think seriously about a mega program of resettlement from the countries of first asylum of those situations that are more dramatic, in particular the Syria situation. I have the impression that this would be easier if it is not only a European initiative. I doubt the European Union as such has the capacity to come together and to put one of these initiatives on the table and approve it. But I think that it is possible to gather a coalition of the willing, including a number of European countries, the United States, Canada, Australia. I was yesterday with the Canadian Prime Minister, and Canada is, as you know, taking some very bold measures in this regard. I've seen Germany totally open to this concept. I've seen Sweden totally open to this concept. In the US, I know that there is a complex debate in Congress about Syrian refugees, but the U.S. has always been the largest resettlement country in the world, and so it is clear for me that if it would be possible to have a meaningful mega program of resettlement, then I believe it would also be possible to overcome the present situation, that is a situation in which you have borders that are closed, people that are still trying to move based on smugglers and traffickers that, I mean, risk their lives and violate their human rights in an horrible way, and the mechanisms in place are clearly not adapted and not adjusted to the dimension of the problem. I would strongly advocate in favor of this mega resettlement program, or the combination of resettlement with humanitarian admission, visas of different natures, working visas, student visas, family reunification programs, trying to create the conditions for a meaningful response capacity to what is the dramatic situation of refugees in countries of first asylum, where it will be very difficult to dramatically improve their living conditions, and when the ways that they had to move, even if that movement was in itself a dramatic problem because they were dying in that movement and seeing their rights violated, but it was the escape route they had when that escape route is no longer there. And then I would strongly encourage the capacity of countries to come together in relation to the possible offer of other solutions. In some situations, I believe legal migration can be a way to minimize this problem. We were discussing recently with Malaysia, for instance, the possibility for some of the groups that came from Myanmar. Malaysia is not a signatory to the convention. Malaysia is has no refugee status granted by the Malaysian state. Only UNHCR does it in Malaysia and for resettlement. But if a legal migration situation could be envisaged for some of these groups, that would be an important step forward. And on the other hand, knowing that it is difficult to make some countries accept a perspective of local integration, to at least, with a combination of development cooperation policies, border management cooperation mechanisms, and others, to have the possibility to have countries in first asylum accepting for at least part of the refugee populations they have a system of, I would say, self-sustainability, a possibility for them to work, a possibility for them to have their children in school, and the possibility for people to, even if in a temporary basis, to have some hope in relation to their living conditions. But that would require, again, a meaningful increase in the development cooperation mechanisms to these countries, and the guarantee that they would be not left alone. Because if they are left alone, I'm afraid that we might start to see situations of massive refoulement into areas of conflict. That would be a tragedy that we need to avoid at all costs. Finally, I would like to say something about migration in this regard. It is clear that in a world in which most of the migration would take place legally, and it's clear that migration is part of the solution, not part of the problem of today's world. I live in a country with a fertility index of 1.2. I usually give the example of my mother because it's the example I live in my family. My mother is 93. She has permanently one person taking care of her with this kind of, relatively easy and small healthcare capacity. I've never seen a Portuguese taking care of her. And Portugal is a relatively poor country in the European context. I was in Geneva, I've never seen a Swiss taking care of elderly Swiss. And I think the same happens in Germany or in any other European country. So migration is part of the solution of our problems. And I'm not talking only about chosen migration of high-tech prepared people. I'm talking about the people to take care of elderly people in societies in which elderly people is becoming the majority or at least a very large chunk of the population. And if that is the case, in a globalized world that has an asymmetric globalization, where money moves freely, goods and services tend to move also more and more freely, but people are facing more and more obstacles to move, knowing, and even if I am a socialist, I learned early in my life that markets work, and that there is increasingly a global labor market, and that in markets, demand and offer tend to meet, legally if possible, irregularly if necessary. I think it's better to recognize these facts, to have a non-schizophrenic attitude about migration, and in many countries I see now a schizophrenic attitude about migration, because migration is needed, at the same time is rejected by those that need it. If a serious debate is possible of migration, and if we can open a number of meaningful channels of legal migration, this will, of course, be a very important element, not only to reduce the capacity of traffickers and smugglers to do their business, but it will also be a very important element to normalize the movements of people, and normalizing the movements of people to help to preserve asylum systems, namely in the circumstances that now they are being put into question with the dramatic events that took place in the last few months. So, a serious debate about migration and the understanding of the needs of cooperation between countries of origin, countries of destination, of organizing the movement. Of course, it will not be possible in all circumstances, it will not cover everybody, but it will considerably diminish the present trends that we face with a strong bet on a rational debate on migration, a strong bet on organizing the possible channels of legal migration, and then creating the conditions for a much more meaningful cooperation for solutions in relation to people displaced, resettlement, return whenever possible with the surge in diplomacy that I mentioned, and local integration, or at least the capacity to have a self-sustainable life in countries of first asylum with a lot of support from the international community, are a number of things that I believe are absolutely necessary. It is not clear whether these will happen. There are important movements taking place. There was a debate on Syria in London where there was a meaningful increase in humanitarian aid, not enough, but a meaningful increase. And for the first time, the development dimension being taken into account. Before we would discuss resilience of communities, but not really the structural development problems of those countries. There was a conference UNHCR organized on resettlement that unfortunately was not very encouraging in its results. But there are now two initiatives, one on migration and refugees in the General Assembly of the United Nations, and the other with a summit convened by President Obama. It will be a summit by invitation, only to those countries that are ready to offer either a substantial financial support to these questions or a meaningful increase in the quota of receiving refugees, which means that there are a number of initiatives moving in the direction of addressing the problem, but I think that we need to bring those initiatives together and to have a strategic overview allowing to have a comprehensive response of a situation that unfortunately in the last few months got entirely out of control. I think I spoke too much, so I suggest that now we enter into the debate.
Join me in thanking Prime Minister Guterres for his speech. That was a wonderfully incisive diagnosis of the dilemmas and changes and challenges associated with refugees and migrants, and a powerful call for action at the same time. Professor Aleinikoff and I have just either some comments or questions, and I was
better
going to
comments than questions.
I'm going to put mine in questions, but they will sound like comments. These are not just pure questions. So perhaps I'll start and then turn it over to Alex. My first question draws upon your previous responsibility as the High Commissioner, and then my second question draws upon the responsibility that you are looking towards in the future, which is that of the Secretary General, a position for which you are an official candidate of Portugal. The first is about refugee responsibility sharing. When I typed those three words, refugee responsibility sharing, into Google this afternoon, up popped, at the very first hit, a speech by you from 2012, and this was a speech you delivered to the Swiss Humanitarian Aid Summit in Geneva. And so clearly you have been thinking about this issue for quite a long time. That was the earliest also hit for those three words. And now, of course, the concept is much broader. The Secretary General these days is talking about a global compact for responsibility sharing for both refugees and for migrants. It's relatively easy to say, I think, that it's emerging as the normative consensus, both as a set of words, moving away from the earlier burden sharing, which was the typical earlier word attached to this. But the content of it is still quite heavily disputed when you drill down to the specifics. And that's the theme of the two questions I'd like to ask you first before I move to the second set of questions. The first is, should there be a formula or a rubric through which we determine what a fair share of responsibility sharing should be? Should we leave it up to the discretion of countries, or should we attempt to identify the kind of actions that would meet one's responsibility? Now, the Europeans, as many here in the room know, tried to do something like that, and they developed a formula that included population, GDP, unemployment rates, past numbers of resettled refugees. And they then divided up 160,000 some refugees that they saw moving towards them from Syria on what would seem to be a fair share, that is, a fair share of their responsibility. So the first question is, should there be a formula, or should we just leave this up to discretion? If there should be a formula, many people think that all countries have a responsibility to provide first asylum to those who seek it, and it's clearly etched out in the 51 Convention, but that there are further responsibilities connected with resettlement and financing, that is, to assist those countries of first asylum. And as you mentioned, 86% of the refugees today are living in developing or lower middle income countries around the world. So the question that arises there, many agree upon these three elements of responsibility sharing, but the question is, should these be considered common but differentiated responsibilities of resettlement and financing so that countries can pick and choose where they will put most of their effort if we assume there's a formula that defines what share of the burden they have? And in that regard, should they be completely fungible? Could a country say, okay, we will provide so many tens of millions of dollars, but no resettlement? So the question is, first of all, should there be a formula? And second of all, within that formula, should we allow common but differentiated fulfilling of a fair share, and should it be completely fungible? So that's my first set of questions. Would you want to tackle that, or would you like me to go on to the Secretary General question?
No, I can.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
A good trick not to answer questions is to let them accumulate, so then you choose the ones you want to answer.
All right.
So there is no answer to your question.
It's a good thing I prepared a second one.
There is no answer to your question, because obviously it would make full sense to have, looking at what resettlement needs are. And the estimation of resettlement needs, if I remember well, are around 900,000 people at the present moment, mm-hmm. If I remember well, corresponding to those people that are in a refugee situation and for which we believe that the best solution is resettlement. That, local integration is not possible at all, and that there is no perspective of a relatively early return, and that at the same time have protection concerns of a nature that makes resettlement the right approach. Now, I would say it would be wonderful if you would agree, everybody agree, that we need to resettle 900,000 people mm-hmm. from the countries of first asylum to the areas of the world that can do it. I mean, and that is basically the global north plus probably Latin America, eventually some other countries, and to have a fair share. And I have to say that the formula that was found by the European Union is a perfectly acceptable one. The problem is not in the formula. The problem is in the number. 160,000 has nothing to do with the reality. And it's not enough to have a formula to distribute people if you don't have the mechanism to distribute people. Now, if you have no reception conditions, and you are not able even to identify the people that you can then resettle in the different countries, it was the tragic situation was that countries were offering vacancies, but in Greece it was impossible to find the people for that quota. Because as the situation was, there was no reception capacity, the Greek authorities were providing, after registration, a document that would allow people to take a ferry to the mainland, yes. And people would then move onwards through the Balkans in this chaotic way that we have seen. If you think that to distribute people, you would need some time to allow for interaction with people, to registration and screening of people, and to have a good choice, because people, I mean, we would have to, and this is our experience of resettlement, we do resettlement from all over the world to all over the world, and there is a way to discuss with people where they want to go. There are opportunities here, opportunities there. Not everybody can go to Canada, for instance. I mean, so you need to, but this requires time, dialogue, organization, people working on this. Now, for that, we would need, let us say, 1 month. There were 6,000 people coming to Greece at the time. Mm. 1 month means 180,000 people, a reception capacity for 180,000 people. That was completely out of the question. And so, as there was no system, what we had was this chaotic movement in the Balkans. And that, of course, what it generated was, after a moment in which civil societies showed their enormous solidarity and public opinions looked at the refugees and said, well, we need to receive them, after some time, this chaotic movement through the Balkans, people seeing on television, but nobody's in charge, nobody's taking care of it, governments are completely out of the picture. So, I mean, we started to be afraid. And then what we had was populists gaining ground and people saying we don't want refugees and whatever, and elections taking place and the extremist parties gaining votes. And obviously, in this chaotic situation, only those that really do not want a solution could win. So. The problem is not in having a fair share, I think. Mm-hmm. The problem is having the mechanisms to put it into place. My belief is that we are not in a situation in the world where the international community is ready to agree on a mechanism like this. And so if the international community is not ready to agree on a mechanism like this, I think that what we need is to try to push for the initiatives that are on the table and the summits that are being prepared and try to influence them in order to try to get from them the kind of objectives that make sense, taking into account the nature of the problem. As you know, the Secretary General has mentioned the possibility of 500,000 people being resettled. That could be a good starting point. Let's see if we can reach that starting point with the goodwill of a number of countries. Of course, Europe will probably take the largest share. We're talking about the Syria-Iraq situation. But US, Canada, Australia, Latin America will do it. And so I would say, as we are in a situation where nothing works, or very few things are working, probably it's impossible to define a perfect system, but let's try to seize the opportunities that exist and try to take as much as possible out of them. But if this is true at government level, it is not true at civil society or academia level. And I think this kind of discussion is necessary. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that independent entities should start saying and discussing what kind of solutions would make sense. Independently of the fact that probably in the next few months it will be impossible to put them in place. Mm-hmm. But this is the time to have some analysis of how problems like the ones we are facing can be addressed in a comprehensive way. Because that analysis is also not yet done. And this is a role for your school. Mm-hmm. This is a role for many of the civil society movements that are today discussing this. It's a role for think tanks. And I mean, I think it would be very important to say, look, we have the 51 Convention. It is clear that if we try to change the 51 Convention, we are going to be in trouble. Because I do not believe the international community will be able today to approve a document
that's strong.
Better than the 51 Convention. I think if the international community does not decide to make a convention, it will be a worse one. So better not to touch it. But at the same time, it's clear that we have a number of gaps here. No? So what kind of solutions, thinking out of the box, can we envisage in order to address protection gaps, in order to address solution gaps, and in order to have international cooperation more effective on these issues? I must say that, I would say Alex was probably the leader of this effort in UNHCR to make proposals of new things, but it is clear that there is a lot of thinking that is necessary. Mm-hmm. And I believe we don't need to wait for political conditions to exist to try to start putting on the table what possible solutions are.
It's good to hear that we academics should pull up our socks and get to work and do exactly what you described. I'm going to save my question and then turn it, because it's on the UN itself, and turn over to Alex to let him make some comments on these issues directly on refugees and migrants.
I'll try to be very brief and leave some time for questions from the audience. Just to start by saying, you can imagine what an extraordinary experience it was to work for Mr. Guterres for 5 years. I have many stories, which I will not tell here. We don't have time.
I hope so.
But I do want to say one thing. There were a number of times where there would be meetings, and Mr. Guterres would start by saying, "I'm not a lawyer. I'm an engineer," and then he would launch into a discussion of the law and meaning of protection, and if we're with foreign dignitaries, the importance of people of changing their laws, and if they didn't, we were going to sue them and make sure they would change their laws and properly understand the meaning of protection. So I don't believe he really wasn't a lawyer. On the engineer side, I think what was most remarkable was you've seen this is a man of great breadth of knowledge and political savvy and wisdom, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But I think what he liked most, he can deny this perhaps, was really being in the field and watching field operations and directing where the tents would be set up and making sure there was adequate sanitation and thinking hard about how to work with local officials. And it was all done in the name of producing the best that the agency could for the people of concern to the agency. So a lot of the job in headquarters was endless meetings that are sometimes seem quite long. I don't mean inside UNHCR, I mean with other diplomatic circles and with the UN as a whole. I think what Mr. Guterres basically liked most was being in the field with the people, and that was enormously important for the agency. I'll be very quick because I think we're largely in agreement, and I'll push him just a little bit and maybe play that academic role here. I certainly agree that there was a crisis before Europe discovered it, and that there's great need for the additional assistance to hosting countries and role of development agencies and a desire for a broader picture. I do think it is time for the international community to start thinking more broadly, and I guess I'll make this as a statement and let you disagree with it, but we probably need to think about structural change in the international community at this point. And I say this for the following reason. And I want to focus not just on the emergencies, which tend to get the headlines, but also on the so-called, what we call protracted refugee situations, where most refugees live. Most refugees are refugees for years, for generations, sometime for a lifetime. Certainly the vast majority of refugees are in these long-standing situations, and the idea that people flee across borders, spend a few months in a tent, and then go home is not the picture. The average UNHCR calculated this number. I've always been skeptical of it, but it was the average length of time as a refugee is 17 years. I have no idea if that's right or not, but it is some very long number of years. And the problem has been that the programming for that has always been left to the humanitarians. But of course, when you're 10 years into a crisis, into a situation, it's no longer a humanitarian crisis. It now needs a different kind of programming, one that focuses on including the person in the economic and social system, not necessarily giving them citizenship and saying they're permanent members, but giving them a chance to contribute to those societies, better for them, better for the societies and the like. And the system is not set up to do that because we have this sharp line between development and humanitarian work. And also when you get the solutions in the same way, the kind of comprehensive solution Mr. Guterres was describing here, which might occur as was done with the Vietnamese boat people in the 1970s and 80s and 90s, it was a large-scale global effort, but even there, it mainly was about resettlement. It was mainly about how can we take people who are in camps around the world and bring them somewhere else. I think we're now recognizing that, in fact, these solutions need to also include a development angle as well, either building back the home country so people can go home safely, UNHCR had done this in the past, actually, in Latin America, providing for local integration or providing ways for resettlement as well. And I think to make that happen, this is my comment for as a comment, probably cannot be accomplished within the current structure that we have for dealing with this problem, because the humanitarian work, development guys are slowly getting involved, but there's no way to coordinate those efforts, and basically there's no accountability. No one is responsible for producing that comprehensive response. And a comprehensive response simply on resettlement won't do it. So I guess I will make this a question. If we do have to think about what kind of structural changes are, do you think we do need to think about structural changes, and what might those look like? Some people have begun to propose a global fund for displacement, for example, or a multi-stakeholder organization that could come up with these kinds of plans. Is it conceivable that the multilateral world might move in this direction in the future?
Well, it's I happen to be in agreement. What is clear for me is that it no longer makes sense, the discussion about bridging the gap between humanitarian and development. It's not a question of the humanitarians coming first and then making sure that when the humanitarians leave, the development come. No. I think now we need to look into things, making sure that humanitarian and development actors are together since the first moment of a crisis, and are together in providing solutions for the problem. And they need to do it together. This is very clear for me. The only thing that we must take into account is the need to preserve the humanitarian principles and the humanitarian space in relation to conflict situations. I mean, it is clear that the humanitarian principles, impartiality, neutrality, and independence need to be respected when you are dealing with the immediate problem of a conflict situation. But with that question mark, and the ICRC is very keen on putting this point on the table, we need to preserve the humanitarian principles and the autonomy of the humanitarian space. With that small note, it is clear for me that the two things need to be done together. Now, I believe that requires probably some thinking out of the box about the mechanisms to do it. It might be possible to do it with an informal mechanism of coordination, but we have seen that this is not easy because there are cultural problems that need to be addressed. So probably we need to find a way in which programming, funding, and accountability are linked, and to have someone in charge to make this coordination. And of course there are different mechanisms in which that is possible, but my firm belief is that we are not yet there in relation to bringing together humanitarian and development actors. The good thing about the civil society is that many NGOs do it. It's very interesting that the civil society is already organized largely for that. The UN is not yet organized for that, but the civil society is. I was the day before yesterday, in the forum of the Interaction, conglomerate of the American NGOs, and most of them do simultaneously humanitarian and development things, which means that it's perfectly possible to find ways to do it together. The question is, for the more institutional side of the humanitarian and development part, to really be able to do it. Some good signs, the World Bank. The World Bank now created a fund for displacement, I think. Mm-hmm. And so there are good signs. There are we in UNHCR, I mean, our strategy was very much trying to strengthen our cooperation both with the UNDP and the World Bank. I would say probably it was easier for us to work with the UNDP and for us to work with the World Bank than to have the UNDP and the World Bank together, but that's another story. Because when you are more different, it's easier to cooperate. But just to say that it is obvious for me that the things need to be put together, and that the institutional mechanisms to do it are up for discussion, but you need to have some way to link programming, funding, and accountability.
Good. Thank you very much for those comments. I'm going to open it up to questions and comments from the floor. I recognize many students who have actively worked on this topic and have some very good ideas. And so and colleagues here who also have good ideas and are working on this topic, so I just want to open it up. Could you identify yourself when you ask your question? Is there a mic or just relying upon, there is a mic. So please come up here and ask your question if you'd like.
Zoe, welcome. You mentioned mega resettlement as a solution.
I think the micro was not conceived for someone as big as you, so you need to. Yeah.
Okay. You talked about mega resettlement, and you mentioned the boat people as a precedent, as an example. One of the things that usually is under-described with the solution of the resettlement is that the focus is on the positive and not on the negative, which was pushing back and denying the ability of further exit of people by Vietnam. Today in Turkey, after the agreement between Europe and Turkey, the movement of people to Greece has gone down to several dozens a day, rather than 1,500 a day as previously. So part of the dilemma is in these issues is not that it's not only the push factor, but the pull factor. And mega resettlement will probably be a major pull factor unless it is accompanied by, and I'll ask a question or a statement, depends which way you want to look at it, unless it is accompanied by massive violations of human rights, even according to the convention, within the issue of denial of right to exit. So, since we are not in a situation where there is a choice between non-violations of human rights and violations of human rights, the solutions always that is going to be proposed will involve violations of human rights. And ethically, how would you propose to deal with those questions? And more specifically, how does that relate to the Turkey agreement with the EU?
I mean, we have in the room someone that can explain the Turkey agreement with you much better than me. But if I understood well the agreement was already done, was done after I left UNHCR. So it was up to my successor to express his reservations. Mm. But if I understood well, the essence of the agreement is the following. We have people coming from Turkey by boat into Greece. No. If they come by boat into Greece, they will be sent back to Turkey after being scrutinized to see if they have protection needs in order to make sure that when being back to Turkey, they are properly taken care from that point of view. And for each person that we send back to Turkey, we will resettle one Syrian refugee into Europe. Yes, if I understood well, that is more or less the mechanism. Now, the problem is that makes resettlement, the volume of resettlement, not depending on needs, not depending on the situation of people, but depending on those that are still trying to risk the crossing, even knowing that they are going to be sent back, which means inevitably a very limited number. No? Which probably will mean, of course this will be different from groups of population to groups of population, that we are going to witness an increase again in the Central Mediterranean road, thinking that Italy will be a better place to land than Greece, as it will be difficult then to have an agreement with whoever on the other side. So, what I'm saying is, I have no doubt, looking at the situation in Turkey and Jordan and Lebanon, in which, let's be clear, the borders are no longer open. Looking into the tens of thousands of Syrians that are at the Jordanian border on the other side, looking at the now, I don't know how many, but many tens of thousands of Syrians that are on the Turkish border on the other side, and seeing these countries having a good argument to keep the borders closed, because they say, well, look at what the others are doing. I believe that we need to have a resettlement program and a program of cooperation with Turkey, with Jordan and Lebanon that is based on the needs of the people and the needs of these states to respond to the needs of these people, and not on this kind of, I give you 10 if you give me 10, of those that in the end are able to cross in these circumstances. So I would be advocating for a different view, which is independently of the agreements that might exist, to put on the table a serious resettlement program, and to put on the table mechanisms of developed cooperation with the countries that are countries in the first line, to make sure that the protection space for Syrians is preserved. Because now the protection space for Syrians is simply no longer, for the new Syrians coming, is simply no longer there.
Thank you for coming. We are very grateful. I had the opportunity to study a topic with Professor Doyle on climate displacement. And I noted that you mentioned a little bit of it in your initial speech. And I'm very curious that if we follow the predictions in 20 or 25 years, that will become one of our biggest issues. And do you feel that the international community is doing anything to address the adverse effects of climate displacement? Because climate displacement, like the people who are displaced because of the adverse effects of climate, and it is very contested because there's not a clear definition of who gets displaced by climate, but we do see increased number of people fleeing areas they used to reside in because of changes in climate. And if we just stick to that, there is going to be a huge need to take care of that. And I'm curious as to what is the international community's pulse on that, and do we have mechanisms for that to be addressed, which is a problem in near future of... Thank you.
Well, in my view, climate change is an accelerator of a number of factors. No? There were always floods. There were always situations of drought. There were always all kinds of natural disasters. The Sahara was moving. I think the Sahara started a few thousand years ago, not so long ago. So, there was always change in the world, moving with natural disasters, with the destruction of the environment, and with the movement of people caused by that. But what the climate change is an enormous accelerator of these mechanisms, and in many circumstances, forcing people to flee. The large majority of them remain within the borders of their own country. And of course, the worst situations linked to that are yet to come. For instance, if the sea rises, Bangladesh will have probably 20 or 30 million people forced to move. So we are not yet there in relation to the catastrophic dimension of displacement caused by this kind of phenomena, but that is the risk we have. So obviously, the important thing is to be successful after the COP21 in making sure that there are mitigation measures to limit the impacts of climate change. That is an absolute must. Second thing is to take seriously the commitments made about adaptation and in relation to the funding to the countries impacted by climate change in order for them to build the resilience that is necessary to prevent displacement and to address the needs of displaced people. Because most of displacement is taken inside the borders of their countries. There is, as you know, a commitment of, I think, $100 billion, if I'm correct, $100 billion from 2020 onwards, or 2020, I'm not sure, no, I think it's 2020.
It's going to keep on building up to 2020.
And then $100 billion, yeah. And so let's take those commitments seriously, and let's not just divert funding from other sources to build that fund, but make sure that indeed there is support to those countries that are more impacted to limit the consequences of displacement caused by these factors. And then third, we have those that are forced to cross borders. There is another situation to think about, which is the potential problems related to states that might disappear or lose their territory. And this probably will require some new thinking on international law on how to preserve a state without a territory. But for instance, the water there is probably still,
Because if not, we are creating a problem of statelessness. And how to address these things, which is essentially some islands in the Pacific, as we know. But let's put that apart. But for people crossing borders, what I would like to see, now this is wishful thinking, is that from the Nansen Initiative, we would come to something similar to the guiding principles on internal displacement, which means not a convention. I have no illusions about the possibility to have a new convention, but to come to an international agreement on how these kind of people should be protected and what kind of mechanisms of international cooperation should be put in place for that. Soft law, guiding principles. We are not yet there. This is wishful thinking. It's not obvious that this will be possible in the near future, but I think that that could be an interesting movement after the agenda, the protection agenda that was approved by this group of countries. It's probably wishful thinking, but I think this is the way to go. I don't think that we have any chance to have a new convention on that in the near future.
Thank you.
Please.
Hello, my name is Grace. I'm a member of the International Fellows Program for this year. I wanted to comment on the idea of siloed humanitarian versus development actors in these humanitarian settings or in these settings where there's many refugees. And I do think it's important that those two individual actors, they do need to come together in order to address these issues. But in that conversation, it necessarily leaves out the role of the host country, the country that is receiving. It does not, I don't think it does. I see you're shaking your head. Essentially, the question I'm trying to ask is, what should the role of the host country be in receiving refugees and migrants? What are the first steps that a host country needs to take to truly integrate large number of people that are coming into the country for longer term than just for a couple of months, but really for many, many years?
Well, I think that is exactly the question. The question is, how do we put together development cooperation programs beyond the humanitarian aid provided to refugees in these countries, development cooperation programs aiming simultaneously at the refugee community and the host communities in order to allow for them to live together and to have the refugees with opportunities of a normal life, I would say a normal life, which means basically access to health, education, things of the sort, and to jobs and to work. In some cases, it might be distribution of land. In some cases, it might be just access to the labor market, depending on how things are and what kind of populations we are dealing with. But this possibility to give the refugees a normal life needs to have a quid pro quo. And that quid pro quo is a meaningful support to the development process of the countries. Now, the new Sustainable Development Goals foresee it, saying that nobody should be left behind. Now, if nobody should be left behind, the refugees should not be left behind. If the refugees should not be left behind, they should be included in the national plans. If they are to be included in the national plans, those national plans should be funded in order to allow for the refugees not to be left behind. But this is, of course, I hope a little bit more than wishful thinking, but it will require some effort by the international community in order to make it happen.
Could I push back a little bit on that before we go to the next person's question? There is some fear that if the norm of integration gets very strongly established, countries will say to themselves, these aren't just visitors and guests within our country who someday will go back home, but they will become part of our new population and they will be less likely to give asylum if they think they're acquiring new citizens than if they're simply providing, you know, sources to allow people, even if the fiction is temporarily to reside there. Do we expect it to be more difficult to get asylum if the expectation is that local integration will be thorough and extensive?
You know, that is a matter of how things are presented. Mm-hmm. If you start by saying, we want a program of local integration, mm-hmm. and we are going to fund it, you will have 90% of the country saying, forget about it. Mm-hmm. If you start discussing concrete projects mm-hmm. in which there is a benefit for both local populations and refugees, mm-hmm. you start seeing countries being open to discuss them.
So you need to be, I mean, in some countries there's no problem. Tanzania has given nationality to 170,000 Burundis in 72. That was a remarkable thing from Tanzania. Yes. We have other countries, West Africa, for instance, the residual groups of refugees in all those countries are being locally integrated based on the ECOWAS legal, protocol on movement of people, of money, and goods or whatever. It's it's this kind of not making asymmetric the globalization. There are things in which that, in Africa, namely, it's becoming better and better to be able to discuss local integration with some states. With others, forget about discussing local integration. But it is possible to look into needs and to look into possible ways to respond. I'm seeing here the distinguished representative of UNHCR in New York. She was a representative in Lebanon. And I remember in Lebanon, this was very difficult to discuss. But I remember at a certain moment, even the most intransigent members of the government were saying that it might make sense to allow Syrian refugees to work in the agriculture, because indeed they have always done so. And now they are doing less than in the past. There are ways to discuss these things, but it needs to be with the political sensitiveness to take into account public opinions and the political situation of each country. We need to have a results-driven approach, seeing first that things work before starting to sell a concept that naturally countries will tend to reject.
Thank you. Thank you for your patience.
Hi, my name is Hassan. I'm a student at the J School, the Journalism School. And I wanted to ask you specifically about the protection of the human rights of migrants and refugees while they're en route to Europe or whatever it is that they're going to. I am working on a story about this issue for the journalism school, and I got a chance to travel to the Calais camps where I spoke with a lot of African migrants who had some horrific stories to share with me about the abuses of their rights that they've experienced while they were traveling through Libya. And I was wondering if you could sort of speak about what the EU and in collaboration with UNHCR can do to make sure or to put some pressure on countries like Libya so that the human rights of migrants and refugees can be better protected while they're actually in movement. Thank you.
Well, in relation to Libya, first you need to have a state in Libya to be able to put pressure on that state, and we are still trying to get there. So I think the most important thing in relation to states in which the fragility became so big that in the end there was no state, I think it's essential is to help rebuild the state. In the case of Libya, almost built the state because there was really never a state as such as we have seen it, before anything can be done meaningfully. But at the same time, we need to be able to have a human rights-minded approach in all steps, which means a human rights-minded approach in relation to areas of origin, in relation to areas of transit, but also in relation to areas of destination. And there, it's important that Europe leads by example. And in the last few months, things have been a little bit complicated.
Our last two questions, please.
So one of the things that concerns me the most about this, the refugee situation are the children. Like a great proportion of the refugees are children who are growing up without education, without proper health, without citizenship, if not de jure, many times de facto citizenship. And you mentioned that the international community is not ready yet for an agreement to the responsibility sharing. But I would like to hear from you, which immediate steps do you envision that the international community could take to address the situation of these refugee children? And going a little bit further on that, last semester I did Professor Michael Doyle's seminar, and I did some studies on the right to citizenship and citizenship for the refugee children. And what I envision as one of the gaps that in international law is that the Refugee Convention does not address refugee children, and also the Convention on the Rights of the Child do not address the rights, so the minimum rights for refugee children. So I envision that a solution for that could be an optional protocol on the Convention on the Rights of the Child to address minimum rights for refugee children, such as health, education, and citizenship. And I would like to hear from you if you envision this as a viable solution.
Well, we could spend the rest of the evening discussing all the aspects related to the protection of children and the different conventions, what can be done. I would just stick to what I consider to be the priority issues. First priority, not by order, birth registration. It is absolutely crucial to guarantee that in all refugee situations, all children born are registered. That doesn't mean that they gain the nationality of the country where they are, but they need to be part of the process of birth registration of that country. So this is an absolute must for protection afterwards. Second point is in relation to education. There is a lot of initiatives on this. Norway, for instance, has recently had a summit pushing for an increased volume of support to education. Qatar has had some initiatives on this. There are a number of initiatives. But the funding and at the same time the increased capacity that is necessary to address the education needs of the refugee population is a gap that has to be addressed. Just to give you an idea, two-thirds of the children refugees, only two-thirds go to primary school, but those primary schools, many of them, let's be honest, are just a place for them to be protected more than anything else, because the quality is very limited, but I mean, only one-third has no access to primary education, only one-third has secondary education, and only 1% has access to higher education, which shows that there is a dramatic gap. If you combine that gap with the quality of education, you see that a lot of investment needs to be put in place. And this is related to one of the goals of the Sustainable Development Goals. Mm-hmm. And again, the principle, no one should be left behind. The third area are some key aspects of protection. Protection against recruitment, and especially in conflict areas. Protection against early marriage of young girls, which is one of the very serious problems we are facing, namely with the Syrian population. Protection against forced labor of children. I mean, I remember seeing in Lebanon children of 8, 9, or 10 working in the farms, no? Because that was the way for the families also to survive. I mean, so these kind of things need to be put in place in close cooperation between the host state and the international community. And again, for the host state to be able to do it also properly, the international solidarity is absolutely essential. In some of the countries in which the host state is in itself a very fragile state, it's more difficult. I remember how dramatic it was to avoid recruitment in Eastern Chad, when Eastern Chad was itself involved in a kind of a civil war, and you had the refugees from Darfur, and there were recruitment from all sides everywhere. So obviously, in these situations, it becomes even more difficult, and that's where, for instance, at the time, it was very important to have a European force in Eastern Chad that allowed for the protection in camps to be reestablished, that afterwards led to a UN force, and in the end, the Chadian government decided that it was no longer necessary, and now it's the Chadian gendarmerie that is doing the job. But as things in Chad have quieted down, now the situation is not as dramatic as it was. But the problems like recruitment, early marriage, labor, I mean, children, children working, and these are the kind of things that also require a very labor-intensive protection mechanism in place.
If I could just add to that, Michael, sure. In terms of the necessity of a protocol, I don't think you need it. I mean, refugee children are covered by the Convention on Children, and children are covered by the Convention on Refugees. They're both included. There's no exclusion for them. It's a question of enforcement of those rights. But the rights are all there against recruitment in the Child Convention and in terms of education and the Refugee Convention. The one area that may be necessary is on the citizenship point you were describing, which is merely hortatory, and if I can say this, Article 34 of the Refugee Convention. But the kinds of rights you're talking about, I think, are within both those. The one area I think that you didn't mention, which I actually found most disturbing of all, that I saw in UNHCR camps was a problem of female genital mutilation or genital cutting. In a refugee camp of 350 or 400,000 people that UNHCR runs, basically, with the Kenyans, largely with Somali refugees, it is nearly universal practice for all Somali girls to undergo FGM. And it was something that was very hard to stop, and I view that as a major infringement of human rights. And one, I mean, I would add that to your list of things that. But I think that's also already covered by the convention. This is a question of implementation, not a need for a new protocol.
Can I?
You can mention what you were doing. Go ahead, please.
Yeah. So I envision that there are some gaps with regard to the special needs that this refugee children have and that are not covered by the Convention on the Rights of the Child, such as integration in this process of education and non-segregation. So I do see some.
No, the right of education is clearly in the convention, yeah. Refugee convention.
And so it's not discrimination.
So I don't think there is a problem of international law. I think there is a problem of capacity to abide by the law and implement.
I should just mention, she's not mentioning her most radical proposal, which is for citizenship in countries of asylum.
That would be new
and very radical. Okay, thank you very much. Our last question or commenter.
I'm Robin Brooks. I'm the faculty advisor to a capstone project here at SIPA that worked with the Bulgarian State Agency for Refugees. And I'm sorry that I'm going last and have kind of an expansive question, so you can just choose the part of it that you want to answer. But it seems to me that you had a sort of three-pronged solution attempt at a solution to the problems. And I have some concerns about it, and I'd just like to hear your response. First, you talked about a surge in diplomacy for peace where states get together and stop providing arms, for instance, to combatants in a conflict. But I wonder if you've thought about the fact that a lot of those arms are provided not by states, but rather by individuals, by organized crime groups, by the same sorts of groups that are also trafficking and smuggling the refugees and asylum seekers out of those places. As an example, the Bulgarian manufactured Kalashnikovs that are turning up in Syria weren't provided by the Bulgarian state. How do they get there, and how do we deal with this rule of law problem that isn't so much a diplomacy for peace problem? Second, you said you'd, and I really liked your attention to the idea of fragility and the need to address that, but you said we should increase the capacity of states to absorb. But what do we do about states that don't actually want to absorb? There are countries that specifically prefer to be a transit country, or states that haven't actually ratified the additional protocol to the 1951 convention and therefore don't actually recognize anyone who doesn't come from Europe, for instance, in the case of Turkey, as a refugee at all. They don't want to absorb. So how does increasing their capacity solve that problem? And then.
Sorry, the countries don't want to absorb?
To absorb refugee flows or an influx of asylum seekers or migrants. And last, on the question of, or on the solution of a mega program of resettlement, I really appreciated Professor Barkan's point that there also becomes a pull factor. And countries like Bulgaria actually have complained that when Germany says we'll accept migrants and refugees, it means that it's not just Syrians who are flowing in anymore, it's not just prima facie refugees, but it's also a whole bunch of young men from Afghanistan who might be economic migrants who sort of join the flow precisely because they're trying to get to Germany. How do you solve these problems and the fact that so many of them are tied to individual interests and to rule of law questions rather than to the broader issues of the 1951 convention and protection? Thank you.
This is tough. Now, obviously, bringing together the key states that are stakeholders in a conflict doesn't mean that you solve all problems. But I think it's a good starting point. Because obviously, if you look at Mali, for instance, in the north, you have the traffic of human beings, you have the traffic of drugs, you have the traffic of weapons, you have terrorist groups, you have all these things. But if we can start by a political agreement in relation to the main parties to the conflict, and have states that are relevant for that purpose working together for that, and this was not always easy in relation to Mali, just to give an example, there were different contradictions, as you might recall, the same, but there at least it was possible to come to. So, I mean, this, in my opinion, is the starting point, to mobilize those in the international community that have influence on the parties to the conflict to come together, to understand that now it's time to overcome our differences and to put an end to this that is a problem for us all. And then, of course, we have to do lots of other things. Yeah. And obviously, one of the things that you have, and I mentioned it, is that you are having conflicts with a multiplicity of actors. And some actors are gangsters in the morning and members of a militia in the afternoon. And I mean, and we know how complex it is to deal with it. But if states that are relevant to the parties to the conflict consider that there is a chance to win and go on supporting the parties to the conflict to try to win the war, then all the other factors will just be multiplied. Now, there are countries that do not want to absorb refugees. Yes, it's true. And that is the problem. What you can do is, of course, it depends now on the situation. Just to give you an example, UNHCR was very active in supporting those that would go to the European Court on Human Rights in order to be able that some European countries were forced to abide by the convention. I just gave the example of the pushbacks in Italy, no? People were being pushed back to Libya, and the court decided that this was not possible, that all boats disembarking in Europe would have to be, the people would have to be given an opportunity to ask for asylum. This was one of the interesting discussions about the Turkey-EU agreement, because the truth is that the Greek government cannot pick the boats and just send them to Turkey. They need to accept people and give people an opportunity to ask for asylum. Then we can discuss whether or not they will have a chance for that to be recognized. But that's another question. And one of the things UNHCR has been saying is that both Turkey and Greece are not prepared to implement properly an agreement of this nature. But that's another question. No, I mean, but just to say that one of the ways is to go to a court. No, if that can work. But in some situations, there is no court that the country will accept. So you can try to persuade the country, and then if the country is not able to be persuaded, you can denounce it. But there is one thing you cannot do is to, the international law does not necessarily mean that everybody will abide by it. But you can at least push for it and then denounce it if, in the end, that is not done.
May I have a short follow-up on that? Sure. Some countries like Bulgaria actually appreciate the use of courts. Bulgaria specifically seems to prefer to be a transit country, and therefore
a transit country,
and for that reason keeps a substandard system of reception centers so that Germany can't return people to Bulgaria because it's considered unsafe. They use courts in Germany so that people don't get returned. So it's a two-way street.
Well, I wouldn't like to go on discussing the Bulgarian case in depth, because that could even have a different interpretation. But I have to tell you that at a certain moment, UNHCR was providing assistance in Bulgaria. Does that make any sense? I don't think so. But this shows how bad the things were. I must confess, I'm always a bit passionate in the discussion about pull effects. Because usually, and it was obviously not your case, those that argue with the pull effect is just to make sure that they do the wrong thing. And to blame those that do the right thing. And in the example you gave, it was a country blaming another because that other was doing the right thing. And as the first country did not want to do the right thing, they would say, oh, they are having a pull effect. Now, there is, when you do things properly, when you do things properly, there is always a risk that the fact that you do things properly becomes an attraction factor. It is not by chance that most of the refugees wanted to go to Germany and Sweden. It's because they had the best asylum systems. No, I mean, so what is the way to avoid the pull factor? Is not to have an asylum system at all and to kick everybody out. If you kick everybody out, there is no more pull factor. No. If you mistreat people, people will not come. That's obvious. But I don't see things like that. I think we should do the right thing. And if we do the right thing together, and we all do the right thing the same way, then there is no pull factor. The problem is that when some do the right thing and some do the wrong thing. And then, of course, there is a pull factor, and those that do the wrong thing try to blame those that do the right thing because they are becoming the pull factor. So here, what I believe is necessary is to, I mean, try to create, in the cases that you referred, an harmonization of European asylum practices that would allow this kind of factor not to exist, and at the same time to put in place the mechanisms also to allow the asylum system not to be abused. We have always been in favor of the fact that those asking for asylum in Europe and recognized not to be in need of protection, or asking that in the United States, or asking that in Japan, or asking that anywhere else, the state should have the right to send them back, provided their human rights and their dignity is respected. This is obvious. And one of the things that we have insisted since the beginning in relation to this question in Europe was, it is vital to put the readmission agreement with Turkey that was already agreed in the past for 2017 onwards, if I'm correct, to put it in place as quickly as possible and to see with Turkey how this can, independently of all the other aspects of the agreement. Because obviously, what happens in many countries is that you have an asylum system that takes months to take a decision, with then the possibility to have a recourse, and then a few more months and whatever. In the end, you are rejected and nothing happens. I mean, so we are not fundamentalists on this. We recognize that it's not only protection of people and not taking into account the interests of states. No, we are legitimate interests of states to be taken into account. And one of these is that a state has the right not to receive the people that is not in need of protection. But for that, you need to have an adequate mechanism of return. And this has proven to be one of the most complicated issues. And this, I think, is the reason why the agreement with Turkey went that direction, not that the direction it went, and not this kind of direction. But that's another story that would lead us to a very interesting discussion, but probably for another occasion.
Mr. Guterres, thank you very much for that wonderful introduction and for the candid and fiery way that you've responded to all of these questions. Given that you're also running for Secretary General, I saw how subtly you preserved the Bulgarian vote in your comments right now.
No, it's on the contrary. It's the fact there is a Bulgarian candidate that may be very, very soft in relation to Bulgaria.
Very good. Well, it's wonderful electioneering. We wish you the very best, and if the UN is so fortunate as to have you as Secretary General, we're in for a lively 10 years. So thank you very much for joining us and for your comments this evening.